Good morning. Oh, how are you? Oh, that was weak. I love y'all guys, but that was weak. How are you? All right, just making sure. Oh, love you, Russell. All right, let's all stand up. Oh, let's lift our voices together. His mercy is more.
Good morning, everybody. It is good to see everybody here this morning. Now that we all can just take a nap while I'm preaching today, as everybody is probably going to need a little extra few minutes of sleep this morning. But we are grateful that you're here to spend this time in worship with us today. It's always a joy to gather together here at High Point for the purpose of praising our Lord and our Savior. If you are visiting with us today, we'd love to have a record of that visit. You'll find some guest information cards in the pews in front of you. If you'd be kind enough to take one of those and fill it out, and then place it in the offering plate when it's passed a little bit later in our service time today. As far as announcements go for today, the Women's Bible Recap is this afternoon at 4:30, Deacons Meeting as well at 4:30, and then we have Business Meeting on our regular schedule as well tonight. And then during the week, there's really nothing out of the ordinary that's going on this week as our regular announcements go, so nothing else to talk about there. Also, next Sunday, Brother Don Embry is going to be filling in for me, and we're going to have the Lord's Supper. Carol and I have a grandson in North Carolina who has been saved and is being baptized on Sunday. So we're heading to North Carolina to see his baptism this weekend. So that's a good part about getting to be a granddad. That's always a good excuse to miss church, right? To go to somebody else's church, someplace else to participate in those kind of times. One other major announcement that's significant, the senior adult banquet, which was scheduled for this Wednesday, has been moved till next Wednesday, the 20th. So keep that in mind for those folks. You'll see the program that's going to be there as well. This is also the time for us, if you haven't picked up and prayed through the prayer guides, there's still some here at the front, and you can pray through those things anytime you want to. We're also receiving our Annie Armstrong Easter offering. And somebody says, well, a lot of times it doesn't fall exactly at Easter. That's just sort of the way it's been through the years. Sometimes it gets close to that date. And so with that being the case, we are receiving that throughout the month. And our goal as a church is $3,000. All of this money goes to the North American Mission Board. When we started praying this last week, there were three stories that we were sort of, or three people we were sort of introduced to. One of them's name was Roni. The other person's name was Elizabeth. And the final person's name was Maki. And you're going, well, Elizabeth sounds pretty much like one of our names. What about the other ones? Well, you've got to realize we've got people from all over this world who come to America and make this place their home. And each one of these three stories we were just introduced to last week were about people. One who'd come from Venezuela, one lady who had had, she was on her third abortion, and just wandered into one of our churches and one of our ministries somewhere and got her life turned around. And the other guy was a pro boxer. And what's exciting about all three of those people? They all came to Christ. And part of the reason they came to Christ is because you and I contribute, every week when we give, we contribute to our cooperative program, which goes a long way towards doing missions. And then a couple of times during the year, we have special missions offerings to help with some of these special needs. And so that's one thing about reading. We prayed for missionaries all those other days, but on the first day, they did something a little different this time. They introduced us to three people, and then today, they told us what happened to those three people. And the good part is they all came to know Christ as Lord and Savior and had their hearts and lives turned around. If you have your Bibles today, I would encourage you to take them and turn to the book of John, chapter 11, and I'm going to read verse 38, probably down through early part of the 40s. John chapter 11, verse 38. Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. When he said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. Or if you got a King James, it's come forth. Then the dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes and let him go. Therefore, many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus did believed in him. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done Then the chief priest and the Pharisees called a meeting of the Sanhedrin, which was the ruling council of the Jews. Let's pray together. Our Father, during the past 5 weeks, we have spent time examining repentance, denying of self, the great love that you have for us, and also about the possibility that we can draw near to you. And today, Father, we focus on one other exciting aspect of who you are during this season leading up to Good Friday and Resurrection Sunday. And Father, that is the fact that you have resurrection power. Father, not only did you call Lazarus to come forth and come out, but Lord, that same invitation is extended to every single one of us to come out of the darkness associated with our sinful lifestyles, to come out of the darkness ultimately associated with death, and to experience the fullness and the newness of life in you. Thank you, Father, for physically showing us what you also can do for us spiritually. Because you do come alongside of us, Father, and you do invite us on a regular basis to come into your presence. Thank you so much for the powerful wooing ability of the Holy Spirit of God to draw us to yourself. Thank you for saving us, Father. Thank you for calling us out. Thank you for giving us a hope that will not disappoint. We're also grateful today, Father, for the way you've heard us as we prayed. We prayed for healing. We prayed for comfort. We prayed for your calming sense and presence in the midst of troubled situations. And Father, you have answered our prayers, and we want to say thank you. We thank you for being with us through every difficult moment of our lives and through every wonderful, enriching moment as well. Thank you for teaching us through the difficult times and giving us the strength to endure those hard times that come our way. We pray today, Father, for all of our missionaries who serve here in North America. Lord, there's nearly 3,000 of them. Lord, they serve in all kinds of different capacities with all different kinds of language groups. And we're grateful just to have a small part in being able to make you known to others. Help us today to see what it is that you desire for us to be about and how you want us to be invested in your kingdom. Because we understand and know there's nothing like living for you and seeing your will worked out in our lives. We commit this time to you today, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's all stand up together again. Hymn of Heaven.
Upon the one who bled to save me. that day, we join the resurrection and stand beside the heroes of the faith. With one voice, a thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Forever he shall reign.
There is a fountain. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins. And sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains. And sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilty stains. The dying thief rejoiced to see fountain in his day. And there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sins away, wash all my sins away, wash all my sins away. And there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sins away. Dear dying Lamb, thy precious blood shall never lose its power, till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more. Be saved to sin no more. Be saved to sin no more. Till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more. Ere since by faith I saw the stream thy flowing wounds supply, redeeming love has been my theme and shall be till I die, and shall be till I die, and shall be till I die. Redeeming love has been my theme and shall be till I die. Next song is God Will Make a Way.
God will make a way when there seems to be no way. He works in ways we cannot see. He will make a way for me. He will be my guide. Hold me closely to His side. With love and strength for each new day, He will make a way. He will make a way. God will make a way when there seems to be no way. He works in ways we cannot see. He will make a way for me. He will be my God. Hold me closely to His side. With love and strength for each new day, He will make a way. He will make a way. I exalt Thee, I exalt Thee, I exalt Thee, O Lord. I exalt Thee, I exalt Thee, I exalt Thee, O Lord. I exalt Thee, I exalt Thee, I exalt Thee, O Lord. I exalt Thee, I exalt Thee, I exalt Thee.
Heavenly Father, thank You for bringing us together to worship You. Lord, we do exalt Your name. Through Your redeeming love, You had made the way, Lord, and that way is Your Son, Jesus Christ, Lord, who died for us, shed His blood, died on the cross, shed His blood, was buried, rose again, conquered death, and through His resurrection, it meant life for us. And we just thank You, Father. Thank You for Your mercy, Your grace. You didn't have to do that when we were without hope, but now we have hope, Lord, and that hope's in Your Son. Bless this church. Be with Brother Don as he brings a message. Use this offering as you see fit. These things we ask in Your name. Amen.
we always find ourselves checking the batteries beforehand. And I'd been at two bars for three Sundays.
Two bar kind of guy.
And I looked before the service started, and I was still a two bar kind of guy. And as it turned out, when I got through making announcements, I guess I did it such in a powerful kind of way that it was down to one bar and the red light was on all the time. This is not a good thing when the red light's on. So there was only 9 volts that could have possibly kept me from communicating effectively with you all today. So if that's the only dilemma that I've got today, I probably could talk loud enough that y'all could have heard me anyway without amplification. But it helps being amplified to some degree. Eventually today, we will be in John the 11th chapter, okay? But y'all know that by now. Eventually, we will be there. If you want to turn someplace first, turn to Ezekiel. So you say, how much of the Bible are we going through today, Don? Mostly Ezekiel to Revelation. I'm going to leave out the earlier part of the Old Testament, okay? But there's going to be some places we're going to be. Ezekiel chapter 37 will be one of the first texts I call us to look into. But we're basically tying everything together out of what I just read about a few moments ago to kick the service off. For the past 5 Sundays, this makes the 5th Sunday now, we've been finding ourselves preparing for the season of Good Friday and Resurrection Sunday that many of us call Easter. We've talked about repentance. We've talked about denying self. We've talked about the need to focus on love. And then last week, we spent some time focusing on drawing near to God. And today, we're going to focus on one other specific aspect of what goes on and what takes place. And that's Jesus' call to and upon all of our lives. Raising Lazarus from the dead was clearly the miracle, because it was so public, okay? Now, Jesus had raised other people from the dead, and sometimes he had done it. I mean, one time he stopped a funeral procession, but once again, there wasn't probably a vast crowd there during the funeral procession that day. And we know that he raised somebody from the dead in private one time, and he told his disciples to do what? That's right. Don't tell anybody. You know, that kind of word gets out about somebody, that you raise people from the dead, that can sort of perk people up, can't it? And so when it comes to this particular miracle, though, this is one of those miracles where Lazarus has been dead. He has been in the ground for 4 days, which is a nice way of saying he was dead. We would probably use the phrase good and dead, but that really doesn't go together very well. I mean, he was dead. Part of their tradition said that sometimes your spirit hovered around for 3 days after you died. That was just one of their things they talked about. So therefore, by waiting until the 4th day, what did that pretty much prove? That Lazarus was dead. And so dead, in fact, that Martha said, don't roll the stone away because there's going to be a what? A smell. Keep in mind, in those days, some people embalmed, but the people there didn't. They normally tended to bury people the same day they died. They buried him before sundown. If you know anything about even Jewish people to this day, that is still pretty much their custom. I mean, they bury them fast. There's not a long waiting period. They get it done, they get it over with in a hurry. That's why when Jesus does this, though, he does it in front of a full crowd. There's apparently prominent people from Jerusalem that's just 2 miles away that are present. And when he does this, I mean, this is one of those undeniable miracles that lets us sense and see the power of Christ in a great way. And when you see this particular power, you also see something else. You see Jesus coming to this particular spot, and in the King James it says to come forth. In more modern translations, it just simply says to come out. But keep in mind that when he's standing here, I'm pretty sure this was in a graveyard, because this is how they buried people back in those days. And he made sure that he mentioned one name before he said, come out, right? He said, Lazarus, come out. If Jesus had just said, come out, I'm asking y'all, if Jesus had said, come out, what would have happened? Yep. There had been a whole lot of coming outs. That had really shook them up, wouldn't it? I mean, some people left rejoicing because Lazarus, who they all loved, was alive. But not everybody was excited about this, though, were they? The Jewish leadership got word of this. And within 2 miles of their center of operations, what's happening? Jesus is doing something before a crowd that's absolutely undeniable. And they knew they had to do something to get rid of him, or else it was going to ruin their business. Okay? Y'all need to understand, the high priest who controlled the temple, controlled the money because temples were big business. And if Jesus was who he said he was, guess what was going to happen to those people? They were going to be bankrupt. It's sort of what reminds me what happens at the city of Ephesus when Artemis, one of the guys who was the silversmith, they were all upset because nobody was buying the little statues of Diana anymore. Had those guys only figured out the market for cross necklaces? Right? Had they only thought it through about the market for cross necklaces, all they would have done is what? Converted. But what were they? I hate to say it. Most of the time when people's pocketbooks get threatened, what do? They try to take care of what's going to be giving them fits. This is why Jesus and our wonderful Heavenly Father are in the business of calling us. This book is all about God speaking to us and us being able to understand Him when He speaks to us. There's Abram who was called to go to a land that I'm going to show you. He didn't know where he was going. He said, I'll just show you. A land he would never possess or own, but his people would possess and own someday. Moses received his call at a bush that was on fire, yet it was not consumed. And God called him out as an 80-year-old man in the middle of this wilderness. And then there was Joshua, who received his call to take over from Moses, which I'm sure had Joshua shaking in his sandals. But he received that call as well from God. And then there is in Isaiah chapter 55 and verse 1, the call from Isaiah the prophet to come. To come, you don't need money. I can give you the water of life. I can give you something to eat. I can take care of you and quench your needs for all time. And then there's our Lord and Savior who was in the business of calling just regular, ordinary people out. He called out fishermen, tax collectors, people that were zealous for the cause of Judaism and other things, a broad assortment of people. He simply extended a call to every one of them. And then those great words in Matthew 11, 28 and 29, come unto me, all you who are burdened and weary, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls if you'll only do what? Come to me. I mean, even the very end of the book in Revelation, when you get over to the 22nd chapter, latter portion, it says the Spirit and the bride say come, and let all who hear say come, and come and receive the living water that will quench your thirst forever is what it tells us. I mean, from start to finish in God's Word, it's all about the wonderful call He extends to us. And He's never experienced a shortage when it comes to extending calls to us. And when you think about this particular call that He gives us today, the call for Lazarus to come forth, or for Lazarus to come out, it just reminds us, once again, of God's unbelievable power. There's five things I'm going to say about that today that's usually good. The more, the faster. The less, the longer. Are you with me? You say, that's not true. Yeah, it is. It can be. But you know, let me let you know a secret. I never know how long they're going to last. I sometimes have got it planned and I think I know how long it's going to last. But sometimes the boss changes the plan. And I've learned to try to end and finish when he ends and finishes. And I don't always get that done right, but that's what I'm always trying to do. To begin with, Jesus' call to come out is based on God's promise of his resurrection power. Jesus' call to come out is based on the promise of his resurrection power. And that's why I told you all to turn to Ezekiel chapter 37. Ezekiel 37 is one of those great chapters, even though sometimes people just read it solely for the fact that they say, okay, this is prophesying that Israel, once again, is going to become a nation. And that's what happened, right? Talking about a great historical miracle that happened 5 years before I was born, maybe 4 years before I was born, was that a nation that hadn't been a nation for 1,900 years became a nation again. Y'all don't think that's miraculous? You say, well, the Jews were always around, but they weren't a nation, were they? But in 48, they became a what? A people who hadn't been a people all of a sudden found themselves having a home again where? In Israel. Y'all have got 11 to 14 on the screen. I'm going to read a little bit before that to get us into it because the story's so good. The hand of the Lord was on me. This is verse 1 of Ezekiel 37. And he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, Son of man, can these bones live? Now think about it. You're a prophet. God calls you to look over this whole valley, and all it's full of is dry bones. And he asks you a question. Son of man, can these bones live? And you're probably thinking to yourself, fat chance. Right? That's what you're probably thinking to yourself. There's not much of a chance of this happening. But the prophet says, Sovereign Lord, you alone know. Then he said to me, prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the Sovereign Lord says to these bones. In other words, God has him preaching to what? A bunch of dead bones. That's a stretch too, isn't it? But he does. It says, this is what the Sovereign Lord says to these bones. I'll make breath enter you, and you'll come to life, and I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover your skin. I'll put breath in you, and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the Sovereign Lord says, come breath from the four winds, and breathe into these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded, and breath entered them. They came to life, and stood up on their feet, a vast army. Now talking about the power of taking something that's dead and making it alive again. And although a lot of people put more stress on this for the nation of Israel, this is about God's resurrection power. This is about speaking a word to people that are frustrated, that are disgusted, that are disappointed, that don't seem to have any hope at all. And he says, listen, there is hope. If I can take this valley of dry bones and make them come alive again, I can make you come alive again as well. I can bring you up from the dead. And then he says, getting to our text in verse 11, 12, 13, and 14 here. Then he said to me, Son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off. Do you get it? Sometimes when things are frustrating and we don't seem to have much hope, you just need what? You need a Holy Spirit booster shot. You need to be reminded of who God is and what God does and how God's going to help us out throughout the course of our lifetime. Son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, this is what the sovereign Lord says. My people, here's what he says I'm going to do. I'm going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord, and I will open your graves and bring you up from them. I will put my spirit in you, and you will live, and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken and have done it, declares the Lord. This is our promise. We have the promise that God says he can bring us back from the dead, right? We call it the resurrection. And this is the hope we have. When this life comes to an end, it's not all over. We find ourselves going to be with the Lord, but someday these old bodies are going to get what? Resurrected. And this is our hope. This is our promise. This is what encourages us. And to me, what bolsters this even in our own lifetimes is the fact that we've seen God fulfill part of this through the nation of Israel who still doesn't believe in him. Right? They don't really believe in him. Most people in Israel, the Orthodox Jews are really devout. Besides for that, most of the rest of them are atheists. They believe God is more a God of their tradition. But does that mean God doesn't love them? He loves them, and he's made them a promise, and he's kept the promise. And he'll ultimately keep this other promise where they're going to finally do what? When the fullness of our number comes in, what's going to happen to them? I mean, all we are is wild olive branches grafted into the true vine of Israel. Okay? We're not the natural ones. We're the unnatural ones that he's allowed us to have a part in his kingdom. And for that we say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the hope that we have in you. Second thing. Jesus' call to come out is predicated on Jesus being the resurrection and the life. And this is where you can get back to John's gospel, John chapter 11, and verse 25 and verse 26. As you know, Jesus did not rush to get back when he heard that Lazarus was sick, correct? Could he probably have gotten there in time to heal him before that happened? Let me ask you another question. Could Jesus not have healed him long distance? Did Jesus heal anybody else long distance? Yes. So he could have healed him long distance, right? But he didn't heal him long distance, did he? God has different plans sometimes. And we don't understand all the ways he works things out. But we know this particular time, this was all part of God's plan, because God wanted to show the power that Jesus had publicly to bring people back from the dead. And he also had to do something to stir the leadership up more to come against him. He hardened their hearts by doing what? By giving them another chance to believe. Here you are. Some of your own people have seen Lazarus raised from the dead, and what do? You turn around and run back to Jerusalem and try to figure out a way to apprehend him or kill him. They had another opportunity right there. God was present with them in power, and what did they do? No, God, we're not going that way. You know, in the 25th and 26th verses, Jesus had been trying to comfort Martha to some degree. Back in verse 23 of the 11th chapter, Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. So, She was a good Jew who believed in the resurrection, who knew the power of the resurrection, as mentioned in Ezekiel chapter 37. Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die." Do you believe this? We know when we look at our Lord and Savior and what is said about life in God's Word, we know in John's Gospel alone He's the bread of life. We also know He's the way, the truth, and the life. We know He is the true vine, and apart from Him, we can do nothing. And we know here that He simply refers to Himself as the resurrection and the life. Jesus is life. He has power over sin. He has power over death. And although our world no longer lists death as one of their fears that they have, there was a time when I was growing up in my earlier days when they were taking, you know, sample polls of people, that oftentimes one of the greatest fears that people had when I was coming along was, you know, when I was a child and a teenager, was death. But now, the top 10 things that people are afraid of, death is never included any longer. Do I find that strange? I sort of find it strange, but I don't find it strange because a lot of times we're liars. Brother Don, you just called us liars? I call myself a liar. Sometimes we lie about what we're afraid of. And sometimes people have put death completely out of their mind because they think that is so far off in the future that it can't happen to them. I don't know about y'all, but when I was 10 years old, living 68 miles from Memphis, and the Cuban Missile Crisis was going on in 1962, and I heard they had one of those big nuclear weapons aimed for Memphis. I don't know why they want to kill people in Memphis, but when you heard that as a kid, they had a missile aimed for Memphis, and you lived 68 miles away from there, and you knew where the storm shelter was. It was underneath the stadium where your dad coached football. And you were pretty sure that there wasn't anything in that stadium that could block any kind of negative gamma ray. You figured you might have what happened to you if they sent a missile right there. I was 10 years old, y'all. I was a little worried about that. Y'all do listen to the news sometimes, don't you? There's nothing that scares you like even this last week when a certain leader in another country told us where he had the 14 missiles pointed at us. And one of them's in Missouri, less than 200 miles from here. Well, nobody's going to shoot those things. That's what we don't know, right? But we live in a time where people don't really think very much about it because they think things are under control. And they really aren't. That's why, at the end of the day, people sometimes are just afraid of death, but they've just pushed it so far from the center of their consciousness that they just don't think much about it. But listen, we need to be concerned about death and what happens at the end. And as the late Adrian Rogers said prior to his death, he said, "I just can't believe that nobody any longer is concerned about heaven or hell." He said, "There was a time when people, if you just started talking to them about heaven and hell, they knew what you were talking about." He says, "Now you talk to people, and it's like, that doesn't make any difference." Well, folks, we believe that if you're one of God's kids, you get to go to heaven. And we believe if you don't go to heaven, you're going to go to hell. And hell is being cut off from God for all eternity, with no chance of it ever turning around. That is hell. And you can describe it in a whole host of terrible, awful ways, right? Fire that doesn't end, a stench, a smoke. I grew up in a little town in Bolivar. We had a city dump that caught on fire every summer and smoked the whole town over. I had no problem figuring out what hell looked like. You see, Gehenna, when I was a kid, Gehenna was right over behind what was then the black high school, which later became the middle school there in town. There was an old dump over there, and it caught on fire. And I mean, for days, our town was covered in what? Stinky smoke. And Gehenna, the valley outside of Israel, was the garbage dump, and that's where fires burn continually. I'm reminding you, if you're cut off from God for all eternity, you will not have another chance to turn things around. Your chances and opportunities are now. Third thing, Jesus' call to come out is to come out of darkness into his glorious light. There's another promise that gets tied together with John 11, 25, and 26, and that's over in John chapter 8 and verse 12. And to get all this to flow together really well, you've almost got to turn back to John chapter 1. If you ever like just to read straight through books, like a book in the Bible, I know most of the time we don't do this, but we ought to. One of the great things about John's gospel, if you read through and look for certain words, those certain words pop out. In John chapter 1 and in verse 4, it says, "In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." And then you get to John 8:12. Whenever Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." And that's what Jesus calls us to. He calls us to come out of darkness into his glorious light. You see, we always associate death with what? Darkness, right? That's how we always associate it. You know, it used to be when a movie came to an end, there would be two words that would pop up on the screen, right? That helped us people that weren't very smart all those years ago to know when it was over, correct? It said the end, correct? Nowadays, they just start rolling the credits. They hardly ever say the end. And you know why they don't say the end? Because they're going to make another one, right? Right? They're going to make a sequel or a prequel. I'm going, I think I needed the prequel before I got the other one. But this is how they do it, but they don't say it anymore. But, you know, it's sort of like if you go to a play somewhere and there's a curtain, or a concert somewhere and there's a curtain that's drawn and comes open and shuts. You know when things are over. And sometimes in life, this is what happens. And here's where Lazarus was. He'd been dead for 4 days. And when that stone was removed, Jesus invited him to do one thing. To come out of the darkness associated with death and to come into the glorious presence of his light. And every single day we live, God extends the same call to us. He says, "Jonathan." He says, "Shanna." He says, "Carolyn." He says, "Gary." He says, "Joe." Every day, he calls out to every single one of us to come out of the darkness associated with anguish and anxiety, with depression, He speaks to our hearts all the time in the midst of our trials and our troubles and everything else terrible that's going on and taking place. He calls us to do what? To come out. No matter what you're going through, he is right there saying what to us? "Don, come out! I have got the power to free you, loose you, and deliver you. Come out." I mean, come out of the darkness associated with all of this and come into my glorious presence of light. He says, "I'm the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but have the light of life." He actually further explains this a little bit better. The Apostle Paul does over in Ephesians, the fifth chapter. In verse 8 through about verse 13 or so, he says it this way in Ephesians 5:8. If I get my Bible flipped over here, one more page. For you were once darkness, but now you're light in the Lord. Live as children of light, for the fruit of light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. And find out what pleases the Lord. Have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. It is shameful even to mention what the disobedient do in secret, but everything exposed by the light becomes visible, and everything that is illuminated becomes a light. This is why it is said, wake up, sleeper, rise up from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. And we've got a God that comes to us every single day in the midst of everything that goes on and says to us, come out. A fourth thing, Jesus called us to come out of death associated with sin into the newness of life. The Apostle Paul put it this way in Romans chapter 8 and verses 10 and 11. But if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of His Spirit who lives in you. Or as Paul wrote the Ephesians in chapter 2, verses 4 and 5, but because of His great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. We have a God who calls us out into the newness of life. And just like He calls us to come out of the darkness of the things we're in, when He does this, He calls us out to what? He calls us to live in the fullness of who He is. The fullness of who He is, John 10 says, I'm come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly or more victoriously. We know God wants us to live fruitful, abundant, victorious lives, and this is what our Lord and Savior makes possible. And every day, keep in mind, not just once in a while, every day God is calling us to come out. And then one final thing, Jesus' call to come out enables us to go out in His power. And that's what happens in this particular account. When He had said this, Jesus called out in verse 43 in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face, which basically was the burial clothes that they wore in those days. Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes and let him go. I actually like the King James here. It says, loose him. Not lose him, loose him. And why did he need to be loosed? Because listen, you need to be free of everything that hinders you and holds you back so you can do what God wants you to do. Because when God calls us to come forth, He calls us to come forth or to come out so we can do what? So we can go out and do whatever it is He has called us to do. The same power of God that calls us out of darkness into His glorious light, the same power of God that delivers us from our sinfulness, the same power of God that has conquered sin in the grave for us, is the same power of God that comes upon us and allows us to go out in His power and do what He's called us to do. And folks, this is what Good Friday and Resurrection Sunday are all about. God calls us to come out. And so today, where is it in your life that God's calling you to come out? Where is it that He's working to loose you and free you from the things that bind your heart in life and keep you from being what He wants you to be? You may have never turned from your sins the very first time. If you haven't done that, it is our prayer today you would turn from those sins right now, place your faith and trust in Him, and trust your heart and life to Him, and answer His call to come out, because He wants to save you today. Probably the majority of people in this room are already children of God. Because you are, you know there's things at times that get a hold of us and hold us back and keep us from being what God wants us to be. And God is speaking to our hearts today, saying what to us? He's calling us, just like He calls us every day, to come out. Our invitation hymn is number 287. Number 287. We do encourage your response today as we stand to sing this hymn.
Take my life, lead me, Lord. Take my life, lead me, Lord. Make my life useful to Thee. Take my life, lead me, Lord. Take my life, lead me, Lord. Make my life useful to Thee. Take my life, teach me, Lord. Take my life, teach me, Lord. Make my life useful to Thee. Take my life, teach me, Lord. Take my life, teach me, Lord. Make my life useful to Thee. Here am I, send me, Lord. Here am I, send me, Lord. Make my life useful to Thee. Send me, Lord. Here am I. Send me, Lord. Make my life useful to Thee.
Let's pray. Father, we want to say thank You for the day You've given to us. Most of all, Father, thank You for calling us to come out. I realize today sometimes coming out has a bad connotation in some circles. But for Father, when You call us to come out, it makes all the difference in the world. And God, You want us to come out of the darkness associated with sin and come into Your glorious light and live lives that bring honor and glory to Your Son's name. Help us, Father, to answer that call by saying, yes, Lord, yes. Because Lord, when we do that, it's amazing what You can do and what You can accomplish. Use us this afternoon, Father. Draw us back this evening as we come back to do a little business and do as well have church this evening and have a Awana. Use this time to strengthen and encourage us all in Christ's name. Amen.